Good morning and a very warm welcome once again to our time of worship together on this day, Sunday the 27th of September. And I hope wherever you've been, whatever you've been doing, it's been something of a positive week for you. Today in our service we come to the very final part of our series looking at the life and worship of the early church. And today we are thinking about the theme of justice in the early church. But as we gather now today, we come to worship God together wherever we are, whether we are still not together in church, but where we are at home. But we give thanks that we are joined together by the Holy Spirit. And we come together in our call to worship this morning, which has a few verses from the psalmist speaking in Psalm 16. A psalm of David. And there he writes, "The Lord is my portion, my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage." And so as David gives thanks there for the Lord's presence and bountiful help, we come together and we sing to God's praise in our opening hymn this morning, which is hymn 28, "Thy Mercy, Lord, is in the Heavens." We join to sing. God, wherever we are, we thank you for the privilege of pausing in your presence now to worship you. We acknowledge that you are holy, mystery at the heart of our universe, and yet you are with us, you are for us in the abundance of your love. We thank you for Jesus, your Son, Thank you that he has taken away all that separates us from you through his death on the cross, and that in his life we find life full and free, walking with him, working with him, and learning the unforced rhythms of grace. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, teacher, comforter, guide, around us and within, to enable us and empower us to speak and show your love where we are. Merciful God, we confess that sometimes in our attitudes and in our actions, we have avoided our responsibilities for love and care, or prevented others from fulfilling theirs. Forgive us, we pray, and by your Spirit, help us as we try to live to make a difference in the week ahead. Gracious God, the life and words of your Son, his compassion and care for others, even as he himself was dying, assure us of the generous depths of your forgiveness and of its restorative power. Help us now, through the energy of your Spirit, to love and live differently, that we and our world might become all that you intended. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And I'm very grateful now for Kofi coming to give our reading this morning.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 37. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The second reading, also from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 6. Now, during those days, when the disciples were increasing in number, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. And the 12 called together the whole community of the disciples and said, It is not right that we should neglect the word of God in order to wait at tables. Therefore, friends, select from among yourselves 7 men of good standing, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may appoint to this task, while we, for our part, will devote ourselves to prayer and to serving the word. What they said pleased the whole community, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit, together with Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch. They had these men stand before the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. Thanks be to God for the reading of his word.
We come today, as I mentioned at the start of our time together, to the final part of our series on the life and worship of the early church. And we come to our theme of justice in the early church. The themes we've looked at interweave in different ways in the life and worship of the early church, as indeed they should do so in the life and worship of our churches today, and indeed in our own personal lives of faith. We discover how we love God through prayer and creativity, how we love one another through justice and hospitality, and how we love our community and our world through learning and mission. As we unfold our passages today from Acts, we see this close link of love for God leading to love for each other and love for our community and world being lived out in very real ways. Thinking about justice today, we do so from an understanding of justice as showing care and concern for those in need around us. Taking our passage in Acts 4, first of all, we learn of the generous common life shared by the believers in the young church in Jerusalem. This passage leads on from Peter and John having been released from prison. If you remember, Peter had healed a man crippled from birth as he and John were making their way up to the temple one afternoon for the time of prayer. But after Peter taught the amazed crowd who had gathered that this had all happened through faith in Jesus, once rejected and crucified, but now risen and reigning on high, he so angered the religious authorities by his message that he and John had been put in prison overnight. The next day, the Jewish council commanded Peter and John not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But it made no difference at all to them, as they boldly said they could not help speaking about what they had seen and heard. Peter and John returned to the other believers and told them all that had happened, and together they boldly prayed, asking God to enable them to speak his word with great boldness. And we learn there that after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. And so we flow into our passage today. And here Luke intentionally makes clear that the fresh filling of the Holy Spirit is shown not only in word, as the believers boldly speak God's word, but also in deed. There is a radical attitude of generosity amongst the believers to want to share what they have so that there are no needy persons among them. Some of them even sold lands or houses from time to time and brought the sale money to the apostles, so it could be distributed to anyone as they had need. It seems significant to notice Luke's construction of the passage we read, and indeed what has just gone before. As we've just seen, we read in verse 31 that the believers were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. From there, We could flow on to verse 33 quite happily, where we read, "With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all." Similarly, verse 32 seems to want to flow on into verse 34. In there, common theme of generous giving and sharing by the believers. Verse 33 leaps in, however, with a powerful start in between. Why is that? Well, with that layout, Luke seems to make a very significant and lasting point. The believers' radical generosity to each other flows from the overwhelming generosity they feel they themselves have received in experiencing God's gracious salvation through faith in the risen Lord Jesus. As Lectio 365 recently highlighted here, Luke creates a wonderful sandwich. Speaking about Jesus, testifying to his death and resurrection, is the heart, the meat of what the early church is about. But very much round that and flowing from it, there is the bread and butter of how they lived because of their joy and hope in Jesus, with radical sharing of possessions and sacrificial generosity towards those in need. Now, selling lands and houses and donating the proceeds wasn't a permanent prescription for the church. But as John Stott notes in his commentary, what we should surely do instead is to note and seek to imitate the care of the needy and the sacrificial generosity which the Holy Spirit created. And that could speak into our lives today as well. Our other passage in Acts today also reveals the early church's care of the needy. And we reflect on it more briefly here, as we thought about it a few weeks ago in our introduction to Philip. This was the episode spoken of then, if you remember, where widows of the Greek-speaking community were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. Something needed to be done about this. What is important to note is that the apostles took the matter seriously. They understood that their calling was to prayer and the ministry of the word. But nonetheless, they asked that seven men of good standing, full of the Spirit and wisdom, be chosen to look after this social care and make sure that no one was being overlooked. Perhaps it seems strange that such capable men were asked to wait at tables. And yet they and we remember Jesus' words in Matthew 25:40, that whenever we serve the least of these, those who are in need, we are serving Jesus. It all becomes vitally important. As each one gave themselves to their respective callings, the word of God continued to spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem continued to increase greatly. As we think about love in action and just and equal sharing, we join to sing again, and our hymn now is hymn 706, "For the Healing of the Nations."
Thank you.
reflected together on how the early church generously cared for those in need in their midst. I want to say a very sincere thank you to so many in the church families of Cockpen and Carrington and Lasswade and Rosewell, who have been doing so very much over the last months to make sure that our more needy and vulnerable members have been looked out for when it's not been possible for us to be together in face-to-face in the more normal ways. So much has been going on and continues to go on behind the scenes, and that is really wonderful. And I know too that you will continue with that even as things continue to be uncertain for us and many still feel isolated. As we work together and share together, we also can make sure that none is being overlooked. I'm very grateful now also to Karen Brown, who leads us in our prayers of thanksgiving and our prayers for others and ourselves.
Loving God, thank you for your gracious gifts to us, tokens of which we give back to you in our offerings made in different ways each week for the work of your church near and far. May we gladly share all that you have given us, so that your love and justice may be seen in action in our community and in places of need in your world. Father God, we thank you that you draw close to the brokenhearted and save the crushed in spirit. Thank you that you never forget the fatherless and the widow. Your concern is especially for the vulnerable and the needy. Lord, may you help us see and respond more and more with your heart and purpose. You have called us to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you each day. Help us to walk humbly with you so that we learn your compassion and mercy and have a deep desire to do all we can so that all may be treated justly in our communities and in your world. We pray for those who are brokenhearted and crushed in spirit, those being silenced, oppressed, denied their rights as human beings, or discriminated against in different ways. We pray for those who have had to leave everything behind and flee their homes and country because of unending violence, persecution, fear, or famine. They still wait day after day, month after month, in squalid conditions, feeling forgotten but longing for a secure new beginning. We pray for those who often feel marginalised in their communities, for Black people and ethnic minorities who struggle to feel welcomed and to belong where they are, or worse, are victims of hate crime in their neighbourhood. We pray for so many who, out of poverty, become exploited by others, greedy for gain. We remember those on the edge financially, with matters made so much worse for so many in the season of COVID, for single parents, for the unemployed, those who fear for their jobs, those who don't have enough coming in to meet their monthly needs, those burdened by debt. We pray for those who are often overlooked and don't receive the support and care they need, those with disabilities and those with long-term mental health issues, those trapped in relationships of domestic abuse, where lockdown has been particularly traumatic and fearful. Gracious Lord, we thank you for all those who press on to be a voice for and bring hope and justice to the marginalised and vulnerable, to the exploited and the fearful. May you give them the strength and resources they need. Help us all to be more aware of the needs in our midst, in our communities, and to be guided by you as to how best to make a real difference. Thank you that you are always present, and we pray for your rescue and your saving hand at work. In the silence, we pray for those known to us who are broken-hearted or crushed in spirit just now, through loss, through illness, through stress, through loneliness, through fear. Lord, in your mercy, may you bring comfort, bring relief, bring hope. We thank you, Lord, and ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you all so much for joining in our time of worship this morning, and again my very grateful thanks to all who have made this service possible. I do pray that you know the Lord's presence with you and before you in the days ahead. But as we close our service today, we close with the words of blessing. May the eternal God enable us to deepen in love, develop in understanding, and be determined in action, that we and the world we live in can move ever nearer to that which God intends. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.